From That's Good Sports, I'm Brandon, just a rip-off, shitty version of Jon Stewart about sports perna, and today I have your top NFL news stories from the week. And I'm ranking them in order from giggle sauce to laser soup. If you don't know which is better, you probably got rejected from community college. I'm saying you're dumb. That's good sports. If you enjoy getting insulted, please subscribe to this YouTube channel. Also, this episode is sponsored by BetDSI.com, one of the best sports books out there. If you use my code GS100 and my link in the description, BetDSI will match your first deposit up to $1,000. That's free money to play with. You can bet on any of the NFL games, all sports games, and esports. You can bet on esports at BetDSI, so whatever risks you want to take, you can do it there. Again, GS100, link in the description. Coming in lukewarm, story number 7. Kickers, kickers, kickers. Panthers kicker Graham Gano kicked a 63-yard game-winning field goal to beat the Giants. Graham Gano channeled Jason Elam, Sebastian Janikowski, and the club-footed Tom Dempsey to send a 63-yard field goal right down the ever-so-elusive gooch to beat the Giants in the final seconds.
Le ha sobrado distancia, le van a servir. Tiene altura, tiene profundidad, va a llegar, ¡Ganó, lo ganó! 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 ¡Señor!
The only downside is everyone on Twitter making the exact same joke over and over again. Is the kick good? Yes it is. Yes. Yes. Oh, yes. 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 No fucking more of this joke, please. Maybe I shouldn't complain about bad comedians, because sometimes it takes one to know one. Mason Crosby missed 4 field goals and an extra point, confirming the only NFL players who can really beat Aaron Rodgers are his own teammates. The Packers' record is 2-1, Crosby and Matthews. And the Browns win their second game in 2018 on a kick in overtime. I said kickers, 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 and I wasn't fucking around. The football gods have spoken, and they said that 60 minutes of Browns football every week simply is not enough. They win a full 70 against the Steelers, Raiders, and this last weekend, the Ravens. Those are 3 games that have resulted in a tie, a loss, and a win. The dumbest thing about the Browns is that my prediction that they tie and play in overtime every week after week 1 is coming true. Nobody's feelings get hurt if they tie. And I want the Browns to tie every fucking game this season, which means with an overtime quarter every week, they would basically play 3 extra games this season. Greg Joseph gave them the win on a dead duck of a field goal that just snuck over the crossbar. Like Andy Dufresne crawling through a river of shit and coming out clean on the other side. One could even argue that the Browns could potentially be 5-0 if they just had a competent kicker or the refs hadn't blown their whistles faster than Rick Pitino at an Italian restaurant.
Victory Monday.
Story number 6. Have you ever tried to decide between rooting for the Bengals or Dolphins? Of course you haven't, because since Boomer Esiason and Dan Marino retired, nobody has given a shit about either of those teams. That's why I want to honor the weirdest fan allegiance in NFL history. A man who loves the Bengals and Dolphins so much he got a tweet from PFT Commenter.
Well, you see, I was born in Cincinnati, did a lot of cocaine in Miami, attended Texas A&M, hence why I'm a big Tannehill guy. I used to babysit Andy Dalton's son, and for the first time ever, both my Bengals and Dolphins are atop their division. Gotta rep you both, you know? Also, I'm just the kind of guy who likes a bowl of hot soup in the shower, socks for my hands when I'm typing, and my dream woman is Kathy Griffin's face on Donald Trump's body with the humbleness of Nicki Minaj and the age of Ruth Bader Ginsburg. That's just the type of guy I am.
Story number five, Blake Bortles, an NFL quarterback throwing the football. I'll let the music and video evidence just do the work on this one. Story number four, Adam Thielen is the first player in the Super Bowl era to have 100 receiving yards in each of his team's first five games. In honor of Adam Thielen's hot start, let's see how many musical Adam Thielen puns I can make in 25 seconds. Which is far, far more acceptable than saying, "Guh, yes. Show me the way to bed, I'm Thielen this. More than a Thielen, hooked on a Thielen. High on believing. When I get that feeling, I want sexual feeling. Feeling, rest his head on a pillow made of concrete again. Are you feeling in the years? Stone away the time. Come on, feel the noise. Can't fight this feeling. Feeling myself. Feeling myself. Ooh, are you feeling satisfied? That's two Boston songs and two Nicki Minaj references. Story number three, Marshawn Lynch not getting the call on the 1 yard line. Again, if there's one thing I love, it's not learning from the past. That's why if I were captaining the Titanic, I would have pulled a U-turn and then rammed that boat right back into that little bitch boy iceberg and showed it who was boss. Sure, maybe I would have met my watery grave. But as long as Davy Jones' locker had Wi-Fi, I would have been making That's Good Washington Senators videos in 1912. It's also why I keep eating ice cream, even though I'm lactose intolerant. Not giving Marshawn Lynch the ball on the goal line is worse than invading Russia during winter. Taking the Hindenburg for another spin, or drafting a Memphis quarterback in the first fucking round. He who does not learn from the Seahawks' past is doomed to repeat it. Story number two, Eagles running back Jay Ajayi tore his ACL and is out for the season. An Eagles fan, EDP445, reacted appropriately.
Eagles beanie, taste these motherfucking balls, bitch. You like that?
The Eagles are 2-3.
Taste them.
Just 8 months after winning the Super Bowl, but I'm not surprised this is how their fans are reacting.
Why can't the fucking line block something?
Do you remember the Go Bears Eagle fan?
Go Bears!
That's so Philly. Or the Eagles fans this weekend chasing this woman around the parking lot?
My dad's cracking up.
Oh, it's okay. Her dad's laughing.
My dad's cracking up.
I take it back. Vikings fans are way more fucked up than Eagles fans. What kind of father laughs while his daughter is about to be captured and forced to perform as Charlize Theron's character in an all-gay, off-Broadway production of Mad Max meets Sesame Street? You're going to let your University of Minnesota Duluth graduate daughter waste her prestigious education on performance art? Who are you? My dad encouraging me to keep chasing my YouTube dreams? Because of the Ajayi injury, the Eagles have reached out to the Buffalo Bills about trying to acquire LeSean McCoy. The Jacksonville Jaguars signed Jamal Charles to a 1-year contract due to the Leonard Fournette injury and Corey Grant going on IR. The NFL doesn't want to pay running backs because they're expendable. But now there's not enough to go around. Sounds to me like the best athletes in this country suited to play running back are now playing esports. Why take a beating on 20 carries a game and potential head injuries when you could pass along those hardships to your virtual counterpart? It's no longer cool to be the hotshot running back or star QB in high school. All that matters is your number of squad wins in Fortnite or your kill-to-death ratio in Black Ops 4. The new alphas play betas. That's the world we live in now. And the number one NFL story from this week is these are not the Patriots alternate jerseys. These are the Donald Trump Stand Up for America jerseys. The pros for this jersey is it appears to be better fitting than a regular NFL jersey. Cons, who the fuck wants to wear a jersey with the president's name on it? Look, I liked Obama, but I would never wear an Obama jersey. Can't we go back to living in a country where everyone agrees all politicians suck and that wearing a jersey with the president's name on it is fucking lame? That's the America I miss. What I'm saying, I'm not trying to pick a side here, okay? But there has not ever been a politician in American history worth having his name on a sacred football jersey. Except maybe Abraham Lincoln. Okay?
I'm a big supporter of a local congressman in District 43, and so I put his name on my jersey. Pretty cool, huh, guys?
No, it's not fucking cool! Yeah, to spice things up for my anniversary, I bought my wife these hot new Ruth Bader Ginsburg court-themed nightgowns. 2 Ruth Bader jokes, 2 Nicki Minaj jokes, and 2 Boston references. Solid episode. Look, my guess is that Trump, in addition to making easy money, created this jersey to make up for the fact that he'll probably never have another team travel to the White House. Unless, of course, the Patriots win another Super Bowl. Talk about a lose-lose. I will say, though, what Obama did when the Broncos visited the White House was far more offensive than Donald Trump trying to make money off of the anthem protests. OJ Obama, come on, man. Thanks for watching another episode of That's Good Sports. Please subscribe here and share this video with your doctor. Next time you're at the doctor or dentist and you're sitting in the chair about to be examined, say, hey, doc, have you seen That's Good Sports? It's pretty all right. Not necessarily worth your time since you're saving lives, but here, check it out. That would be sweet.